Okay, so we will move on to our next gastro topic, and we will think this time about David, who is a little bit younger. He's 19. And David's got quite a lot of reflux symptoms. It was quite surprising for somebody of his age. They are keeping him awake at night, this reflux, and he has been to the chemist. He's got Rennie's and Gaviscon, but he's still struggling with this. And he's come now because he's actually quite worried. It's getting a bit worse, and he's had the odd sensation of food getting stuck as well when he's eating. And so that makes us a little bit worried too. So we sort of delve into the history a bit more. He's actually pretty fit and well, but he has got this past medical history of hay fever. That's the only thing of note with him. Not taking any regular medications at all. So pragmatically, it's sort of quite reasonable to opt for a course of a PPI to see if that settles down his symptoms. So you give him some omeprazole, tell him to come back in 8 weeks to see what kind of difference it's made. It's made no difference. He comes back and he says, didn't really help. So you quiz him quite carefully about compliance. He said, no, he took it all the time, but it hasn't made any difference. So now, well, maybe we'll do a washout period for the PPI and then test him for H. pylori. That's also negative. He's still complaining of the same symptoms. So what do we do next? Do we send him to gastro? Does he need an endoscopy? Should we ramp up the PPI a bit more? Check he's really taking it? Well, this leads us onto this really intriguing topic of eosinophilic oesophagitis, which is a condition that you might have seen coming back on your endoscopy reports over the last sort of couple of years and thinking, oh, I don't think I really recognise that. Where's that come from? And the BMJ have done a really good article about it, just explaining it all and why we are seeing an increasing prevalence of it. So it affects up to about 1% of the population in the UK. And in this big review of the BMJ of it, they give a good description about what it is and what we can actually do about it. So it's a different form of esophagitis to that we see in acid reflux. The inflammation is not caused by acid. It's allergy driven, it's immune mediated. And so you get recruitment of eosinophils to the esophagus. It causes inflammation, can also cause fibrosis and strictures as well at the same time. And the key factor in most of these patients is that they have comorbid allergic disease. So they might have hay fever or asthma or eczema, for instance. It's not IgE mediated, and it's helpful to remember that because it makes it quite difficult to actually test for the allergens. It's due to T helper cells, but you get this sort of mast cell activation and histamine and cytokine release in the immediate area, and that's why you get the inflammation in the esophagus. It much more commonly affects men than it does women, but it does affect children as well. Sort of similarly, more common in boys than it is in girls, but it does affect, you know, all ages. And we're seeing an increasing prevalence. And sometimes when you get sort of, when you're having new information about something, it's a bit like the mycoplasma genitalium, isn't it? Are you thinking, well, it's only because they know about it now that they're just sort of, you know, that everyone's diagnosing it. But it's not that. Yes, we've got increasing recognition. That's undoubtedly part of it. But also, they've gone back historically and looked at histology slides from before. And actually, it genuinely seems to be a true rise in prevalence that we are seeing, which is probably closely related to the rise in allergies that we've also seen over the last 20 or so years. So presentation tends to be in much the same way that we've seen with our patients, so heartburn, reflux symptoms, but also this sensation of difficulty with swallowing because of the fibrosis and strictures that you get, and potentially food impactions as well. So for children, it might not present in quite the same way. You might see a child being brought in with feeding difficulties or vomiting, or actually maybe even faltering growth if it's been that bad. So what is really key to us sort of thinking about it in the first instance is thinking about that patient who's got the combination of reflux and allergic disease as well, and particularly in this age group, these sort of younger males or boys. So making the diagnosis is going to be a gastro diagnosis, unless you are popping down a quick endoscope at lunchtime in a minor surgery clinic. Our patients need to go to gastro for this. So they need to have an endoscopy and a biopsy, which will show the presence of eosinophils in the esophagus. And then they are all treated with a PPI for 8 weeks, and then they're brought back, and then they're re-scoped and re-biopsied to see what has happened. And actually, about a third of patients will respond to the PPI. They have this PPI-responsive esophageal eosinophilia, That's a really good Scrabble score, isn't it? And then the rest of the patients who don't have a response are diagnosed with true eosinophilic esophagitis. So what do we actually do to treat the patients? Well, because some of them will respond to a PPI, those patients are given a PPI, but the mainstay is to remove the allergen, and that's going to be dietary modification, which is about as much fun as it sounds for the poor patient. So the thing that produces the greatest resolution of symptoms is elemental diet. And that has a 90% resolution, but I'd say probably 90% misery for the patient as well. So elemental diet is just that sort of horrible grey liquid, which is a mixture of sort of amino acids and essential sort of carbohydrates and no allergens in it at all, but also no joy. So most people are not going to be able to manage that long term. And of course, it's a very expensive option as well. What is much more likely is that they will achieve resolution with dietary elimination. So these are your sort of six key groups: the cow's milk, wheat, egg, soy, nuts, and fish or shellfish. And if a patient can actually eliminate all six of those, then they do very well, and actually you get about 70% resolution. Your patient might say, well, can't you just test to see which ones I'm allergic to? And unfortunately, you can't, because it's, as I say, it's not IgE mediated. If they can't quite manage all six, then they could start with the first four. These are the sort of the first four over here: milk, wheat, eggs, and soy are the most sort of common allergens. And if they still can't manage that, which is because it is pretty miserable, then the step up option is often the most pragmatic, starting with milk and then stepping up and working in till you find the sort of the set group of food exclusions that work for your patient. And that might be sort of pragmatic to do that in the long term. What about acute symptoms? What can we do for acute flare-ups? Well, topical steroids, it is an inflammatory process that's been driven by eosinophils. So topical steroids are helpful. This isn't, you know, applying some Dermavate and, you know, getting your arm down somebody's neck to actually get that in there. But it's not far off. Rather than oral prednisolone, it's making up a mixture of budesonide nebules with a syrup to make this kind of steroidy slurry. Must be delightful. And then the patient swallows that and it coats the esophagus as it goes down. And actually, that can be really quite effective in settling down symptoms. Unsurprisingly, lots of oral thrush with that, as you probably would imagine. And although it's pretty effective, what we don't have is any really good long-term safety data about it. But that is used for some patients who have got difficult to control symptoms. So are they all going to get better from it? Well, unfortunately, it's a chronic disease, because the allergy driving it is a chronic disease, such as hay fever, you know, and having that eosinophilia. So it's common to get recurrence. It's not associated with malignancy, though, in the same way that acid reflux is. However, patients may get strictures because of the fibrosis that can occur in the esophagus, so they may require dilatation from gastro for that. So in conclusion from this, esophageal eosinophilic esophagitis affects up to 1% of the population. We're seeing it coming through more frequently on endoscopy reports, tends to affect our younger patients. The patient in whom you might want to sort of think, ooh, I wonder if that's going on here. It tends to be your younger patient, more frequently males, but pretty much always got that story of atopy in the background. Food elimination is really what it's all about, which is sort of a bit dull for your patients, but it is actually highly effective. And lots of quality improvement ideas that we could do back in our practice, just thinking about those patients who have this difficult to control reflux despite all their PPIs and H. pylori testing. If you can think of those patients and see, you know, do they have this comorbid history of hay fever, then it may well be worth thinking about in them. Okay, any questions or comments on that section? Yes, over there. No, there doesn't appear to be. So is there any association with smoking? No. Pretty much everything, it's always a good idea not to smoke. But it doesn't appear to be a particularly aggravating or driving factor here. It's mainly about having that atopy and then the foods being the allergens that are driving it.